many believe it. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Yeah, this is amazing grace. Oh, oh.
This is unfailing love.
This is unfailing love.
That you will take my place.
That you will bear my cross.
Jesus, we thank you for all you've done, Father.
Father God, we welcome you in this place. Holy Spirit, fill us, Lord. Let us worship you, Father God, wholeheartedly, giving you everything.
And
give you everything, Lord. Every part of us belongs to you. Only you.
Jesus, I'm my heart, my will, my soul. Jesus, I'm my hopes, my dreams, my world. With joy I lay it down, with joy I cast my crown. Jesus, have it all. To you I bring my praise, my lips, my songs. I live in sacrifice as once reborn. Your life is now my own, your will is what I want. Jesus, have it all.
Have it all, Lord.
Jesus, have it all. Jesus, have it all. To you belongs the glory, the praise of all the world. Jesus, have it all. Jesus, have it all, a blessing and a Lord, a majesty and all. Jesus, have it all. Jesus, have your church, your love, your pride, the joy for which you freely gave your life, radiant in white. And purify, Jesus, have a soul. Jesus, have your worth, your due, your song, the praise of every nation, tribe, and tongues. Let all that be made glorify your name. Jesus, have it all. Jesus, have it all. Jesus, have it all. To you belongs the glory, the praise of all the world. Jesus, have it all. Jesus, have it all. A blessing and a Lord, a majesty and all. Jesus, have it all. Jesus, have it all. Jesus, have it all. To you belongs the glory.
bring him honor and glory this evening. He deserves it all. All of us. Raise up your hands and worship our Father in heaven.
How many of you are thankful for God's forgiveness tonight? Amen?
God, I'm on my knees again. God, I'm begging, please again. I need you. Oh, I need you.
Praise the Lord, family. How's everybody doing? Praise God. It is great to be in the house of God tonight, is it not? We want to thank all you guys for being online with us tonight. We really do appreciate you guys being part of the live stream with us and lifting up the name of Jesus with us here at Core Church this evening. Now, by a show of hands, is there anybody here for the very first time? You've never, ever been to Core Church? Raise that hand really high for me. God bless you back there, way in the back. in the expensive seats. God bless you. If you could just keep that hand up, the usher's going to give you guys a welcome card. We'd love to know that this is your first time with us. If you're online, please take a moment and click on the welcome button there. We'd really be blessed to know that this is your first experience with us on a live streaming. On behalf of Pastor Steve, who's our senior pastor, and his wife, Lori, we want to say welcome to Core Church this evening. Let's give him a big hand clap, guys. Praise God. Just one quick announcement is for the guys, of course. This Saturday, do not forget, Legacy Men is going on this Saturday, 10 a.m. So make sure you get up out of the bed and get out here and just come out and fellowship with. Man, there's just something special about when men get together and start building themselves up in the Word. Is it not? Amen. Praise God. So make sure you're here this Saturday, 10 a.m., Legacy Men. With that said, if you're going to be worshiping the Lord tonight in the tithe and offering, the ushers will be down in just a moment. But you can also text Core Church LA, all one word, to 77977. You guys online, do the same thing if you like, or you can click on the button there that says click here to worship the Lord in the tithe and the offering. With that said, I'd like to invite the ushers down and we'll pray. Father, we are just so very grateful tonight to be in your house. And what an honor it is, Lord, just to worship you, Lord, in the tithe. Lord, tonight we lift it up to you, sir. We thank you, God, for your blessing on it. We ask, God, that you would bless Pastor Steve as he ministers your gospel tonight, and that we would have our hearts and our minds, Lord, open to receive what you're going to say through your word. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen.
The battle belongs to Jesus. Amen.
Victory. When all I see is the mountain, you see a mountain moved.
Amen.
And I so walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear, for I am safe with you.
Sing it out, church.
So when I fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high, oh, the battle belongs to you. And every fear I lay at your feet, I sing through the night.
No man. Good evening. How's everyone doing tonight? All right. Oh, okay. It started slow, but yeah, you're awake. Okay, that's good. Positive sign. Positive sign. Well, it's good to see everyone here tonight. I have a spot of tea to get going here. Turn my phone off because someone's calling me. Stop already. Okay. All right. Well, hey, we're going to continue in our study through the book of Psalms, and we're going to find our study tonight in Psalm 61 and 62. So if you can turn there, and we'll have a word of prayer. Father, we do just come before you, Lord. Thank you so much for this opportunity to get into your word tonight. So God, speak to us, Lord. Cause our hearts to be sensitive and tender to you, and cause us to grow in our relationship with you. For we ask it in Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen. Okay, so Psalm 61 and 62, and I entitled this message, A Tower of Strength. Now, that's a picture in itself, is it not? Not just strength, but a tower of strength. I think there are many of us that need that type of strength often living here in Los Angeles. For there are days that we seem to do just fine, you know, while there are other days, maybe not so much. Then there are those seasons of life when circumstances can take a toll on us. It's when the weight of life becomes a little too heavy to carry. When things start to back up on us, you could say. It's when we're not sure how we're going to pay the bills, and then in the midst of all that, some other thing happens, like the car breaks down or the water heater goes out. Yes, it's in those times when, you know, the next shoe ends up falling and just adds to an already stressful time. It's in those times that we need more strength than what we have. It's when we are tired and we're discouraged and we need help just to get through maybe just another day. Well, King David, he lived a life where he had extreme high highs, and at the same time, unfortunately, he had many low moments also. Times, you know, that we can look at. So as we look into Psalm 61 and 62 here tonight, it's one of those times. This was a very low moment in David's life. Most believe that these psalms were written when David had to flee his own palace, his own home in Jerusalem, for he was driven out. It wasn't from some invading army, from one of Israel's many enemies. It was from within his own family. It was from his own son, Absalom, who went to the people, and he sowed discord among the people of God. He stirred up dissension, you could say. It's not that things were going bad in the kingdom. In fact, it was quite the opposite of that. It was things were going great in the kingdom. David had conquered all of Israel's enemies. The people of God were living in, well, prosperity and safety. And that's when David's son, again, Absalom, set out to undermine his own father. Why would he do that? Well, it started when David didn't punish Absalom's half-brother for violating his own sister. So you have one of David's sons from one of his wives violating a daughter from another one of his wives that happened to be the full sister of Absalom. And David didn't do anything to that other son, causing revenge to burn in Absalom's heart to the point that he arranged to have his half-brother killed. Then after fleeing for 3 years, you know, getting out of Dodge himself, David had him returned to Jerusalem, you could say with a full pardon. Yet David never even spoke to Absalom, which only caused a more deep-seated anger to really fester inside of Absalom, and that frustration was burning inside of his son. It seemed like David could have totally diffused that burning anger inside of Absalom. Hey, maybe you have a lunch together. Maybe, you know, you totally apologize that you didn't deal with the issue as a dad better than what you dealt with it. And you say, man, son, I'm sorry, you know. But none of that happened. And then after 2 years goes by, after Absalom comes back to move into Jerusalem again, with not a word from his dad, it's like, you know, not even reaching out to him at all, and not trying to make any kind of amends with him, you know, not speaking to him. That's when Absalom went on a 4-year smear campaign against his dad. I mean, how much bitterness you think was boiling inside of him? And he would stand at the gate. Now, the gate of the city, you know, when you go to Jerusalem, you know, we're going to do a trip, by the way. I mentioned it on Sunday. It's going to happen next May, you know. And so, you know, it gives you a whole year to save up for it. But it's a fantastic trip. But there's these main gates that come into the city. And it's gates that they would close down at night so that people couldn't come in that weren't supposed to be in. But they would open them up for people to come in and do their business and what have you. But he would sit at the gate of the city. And when people were coming into the city, he would say, hey, my dad doesn't care about you, doesn't care about what's happening in your life, but I do. I care about you. I care about the things that are heavy on your heart. Tell me your problems. And people, of course, like to talk about themselves and their own problems. And, you know, they will come, well, I got this problem and that problem. He says, well, you know, if I was king, I would fix that. If I was king, it's like a modern day politician. You know, don't they just, you know, they say they'll fix everything and then you elect them, they don't do anything. It's the same thing. Well, he won the hearts of the people by convincing them that his father, again, no longer cared about him and that he loved him and that he would be a far better king than what my dad is. And because of the hearts of the people, to this day, people are still people. You change times, you change seasons, you change fashions, whatever. It's people are still people, and people are fickle-minded. You know, they can love you one day and hate you the next day. And because Absalom was beautiful, I mean, he was an extremely handsome man, you would say. He had unbelievable hair. Just his hair grew as long. It was, you know, I'm sure most women wish they had the hair that Absalom had, okay? So he's super good looking, and people are, they're captivated with that. That's why, you know, most of your actors and actresses, you know, they're beautiful people. You know, it's not a bunch of wildebeest up there. You know, we don't pay, you know, to go see a movie to see the ugliest person in the world. You know, they're beautiful people, you know? And so Absalom was tickling the ears of the people with what they wanted to hear. I will do this for you. I will do that for you. Really? And the people allowed themselves to forget all that his dad had done. King David was a national hero. I mean, he brought the whole country back together. He conquered all of their enemies. They were united once again. It was a split kingdom for hundreds of years, split kingdom. And it's like, well, not hundreds of years at that point, but they were after that. But anyway, they were divided, and he brought them back together as one nation again. One nation under God. That sounds familiar, doesn't it? But that's what he did. And he brought the 12 tribes back together. And they also forgot that David captured Jerusalem from the hands of the Jebusites. They said, you won't be able to capture it. And he did. And he made it the capital of the nation. And it was known as the city of God. Plus, they forgot that it was David that brought the Ark of the Covenant that was built by Moses that carried the Ten Commandments inside that represented the presence of God. He brought it back into Jerusalem. Yes, the people of God have been living in peace for so long that they forgot how they got it, that peace, and where that peace came from. It's kind of like when you go back, you know, to the last presidency, the last president we had, people didn't like him because he tweeted this and, you know, that and whatever. And let's get rid of this guy. So now we have this whole new administration. We got the highest inflation we've ever had, you know, super high gas prices because he cut off all the, you know, oil production and everything. And you just look at, see, what a mess we have. But see, at the time, at the last presidency when we had the election, it's like, yeah, everyone's got it good right now. Everyone's got money in their pocket. The economy's good. So, yeah, let's vote the other guy in. Now we're all like, what were we thinking? Okay. Well, actually, I want to take that back. I did not vote for him, okay, the guy that's in office. No, but anyway, but you get the point that I'm saying. It's just, it's easy when everything's going good to say, yeah, kind of forget where we came from, kind of forget where it was, kind of forget all of those things. See, the people were spoiled. And again, it's just like many in America today. You know, we have an entire generation who feels self-entitled, who complain about everything and expect the government, you know, or their parents, their employer to meet all of their needs, you know. So there's many like that here today. But yes, the people of God had fallen prey to Absalom and all of his wonderful promises, you know. And all Absalom was, he was a giant bag of wind. He's full of hot air. He's all talk and no action, for he hasn't done anything for anybody. He's just talking. It was his dad that did everything. He's the one that put riches. They had the highest prosperity that they had ever seen up to this point. You know, but again, you know, just like our modern politicians today who promise everything, but when they get elected, deliver very little. Yes, Absalom stole away the hearts of the people, and all he had to do was throw his father David completely and totally under the bus. I wonder if that would describe any of us here. Maybe you've been thrown under the bus by a friend or a family member, and now maybe you're bitter and unforgiving in your heart towards them. You know, we could all learn a huge lesson from King David. Instead of allowing bitterness to eat us up, you know, he threw himself on the mercies of God. I like what he said when this was all happening in 2 Samuel 16:12. He says, "Perhaps the Lord will look on my affliction and return good to me instead of his cursing this day." So that was when he was leaving, and there was a guy that was cursing him, saying, "Get out of here. We don't want you here anymore," whatever, you know. Just like David's like, "I just throw myself on the mercies of the Lord." Yes, David knew where to go for refuge. And that's what inspired the writings of Psalm 61 and Psalm 62. So tonight we're going to consider 3 points in light of our title, A Tower of Strength. Number one, a fainting heart. A fainting heart. You know, it's like, you know, his heart was fainting because of the pressure and everything that's around him. Now, I mean, you have to put, you know, put the picture all together here. I mean, David has brought peace to the children of God. He's lived in Jerusalem. The stonewall cities has been built up. He's living in a palace, and now he's running for his life out in the wilderness. Wow. And he's not a young man anymore. He's getting older in his age. And so it's not like it's when Saul was chasing him around the desert, you know, when he's young and he could sleep on the ground, no problem. Number two, a silent soul. Sometimes we just have to be quiet before the Lord and just wait on him. Amen. Just be quiet. Don't move. Don't do anything and just wait on the Lord. And number three, a servant's reward. Ultimately, if you do what's right, God is going to reward you. Somehow, some way, I mean, it doesn't matter if you made mistakes or whatever, but if you try to do what's right and you give yourself before the Lord, God will get you out of the pinch. Well, let's read together as we look at our first point, a fainting heart. Let's read Psalm 61. We'll pick up in verse 1. It says, "Hear my cry, O God." I just love how many psalms start off like this, because again, every time there's another and new situation where David needs the Lord, man, he has no problem with crying out to the Lord. He says, "Give heed to my prayer. From the end of the earth I call to you. When my heart is faint, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. For you have been a refuge for me, a tower of strength against the enemy. Let me dwell in your tent forever. Let me take refuge in the shelter of your wings, Selah. He's saying, let me dwell in your tent. Yeah, he'll be sleeping in a tent tonight. Yeah, he's not going to be sleeping in his master bedroom with his ensuite in his king bed. No, he's going to be sleeping out in a tent somewhere in the wilderness. So we can learn a lot here from David on how, again, he approaches God. He does this a lot, as you know, but again, notice in verse 1, he says, hear my cry, O God. I have said this before. What we pray for should determine the level of intensity of our prayers. Meaning, if we're praying about, gee, Lord, what gas station should I fill up my car today? Okay, well, maybe the price of the gas at that gas station will answer that for you, okay? That could be a deciding factor. I mean, don't put a whole bunch of prayer into that. You know, if you're praying about where to go to lunch, well, you know, do you want a burger or do you want a burrito, okay? But when we're praying about something that's a crisis moment for us, when something is just falling apart around us and we find ourselves destitute and we don't know what to do, then that prayer should be a heck of a lot more of a passionate prayer than where you're going to go to lunch or buy your next tank of gas. See, when David says here, hear my cry, that word cry in the original Hebrew language means an outcry. It's a loud wailing like, oh, God, I can't believe what's happening. I mean, I'm on the run for my life. I'm an older man now. There's a mutiny in the city. He was wailing. You know, this isn't coming to God, you know, with just, you know, a little tear running down his face and some flippant prayer. This is a passionate, this is a loud weeping that he's coming before the Lord. Why? Because David is broken. He doesn't know what to do here. You know, he's in a serious need of help. That's why he needs God to hear his prayer. Yes, when we pray like we mean it, God hears it like we mean it, okay? So David, he's a man of deep emotion, you could say, who knows what's going through his mind right now. Maybe he's got a host of emotions going through himself as he's finding himself on the run with this caravan that has come with him of faithful people, faithful men that are with him. He's got military people, government people. He's got wives with him. He's got children with him. But maybe he's thinking all kinds of things. Maybe he's got a lot of regrets. You know, maybe regrets are running through him like, why is this happening to me? Why this? You know, why me? Why now? You know, I'm thrust out of my own palace. Maybe he's thinking, man, I wish I would have been a better father. Maybe he's thinking like, man, I should have dealt with Tamar, my daughter. I should have dealt with her. I should have, you know, been more compassionate with her. I should have taken Absalom under my wing. I should have dealt with my other son that violated her. I should have done all of these things, and this thing wouldn't have blown up like it is right now. I wish I had not sinned against God, maybe he was thinking, and taken on all these wives that I wasn't supposed to take on, breaking God's law in Deuteronomy 17:17, which has led to, you know, who knows how much jealousy. Don't you hate when someone just is calling you? Okay, let me see. Anyway, but it's like, but I wish, you know, all of these things, but maybe he wished he could do it all over, you know, how he handled the violation of his daughter, how he dealt with Absalom. I think we're all guilty of the things that God, you know, that some things that have unfolded, I should say, in our life. I think we're all guilty like David is, you know. It's like we've left things undone in our family at times, you know, not wanting to deal with certain dramas, so we just kind of don't deal with them, and then they blow up later. But if we do not deal with the issues that surround us, then they won't fix themselves. Even annoying things we have to deal with. I mean, we live in Los Angeles, right? I mean, isn't parking a disaster everywhere you go? I mean, it's just, it doesn't matter where you go. Parking's an issue when you live in Los Angeles. And if you get a parking ticket, you know, and you don't address the parking ticket because you don't want to deal with it, it's like, well, that it's going to come back eventually. I mean, like if you don't deal, like you have to deal with stuff when it's messed up, because if you don't, it's only going to get bigger. It's only going to be a bigger problem down the road. And it could even have, you know, we could, you know, have our car impounded because we didn't pay some parking ticket, you know. And yes, life can have many regrets. And this is why we must make the most of doing what is right. You know, I got a tax, you know, we moved up to the valley, and I got a new tax bill for my house, right? And it's like $200, okay? I mean, it should be like 10 grand, right? Okay, it's like $200. And it's like, okay, so this is wrong. So the thought went through my head, okay, probably like many of you would think, like, hey, praise Jesus. It's only $200, okay? And so the thought went through my head, like, yeah, but then it's like, no, this isn't right. And so I could just imagine letting it go, and then all of a sudden, you know, a year and a half from now, I get some bill for 20 grand or something, you know, because it's messed up. So I actually went down the downtown and say, hey, this isn't right. I know I owe a heck of a lot more money than this. And so I worked it all out and everything. It's just because, like, I don't want to put something off thinking like, oh, okay, I'm going to get out of this. No, the city of LA, it'll come back on you eventually, and then it's going to be way worse. See, David said in verse 2, from the ends of the earth, remember, David is on the run. There is a mutiny happening in Jerusalem. He's running again for his life. He said, his heart is faint, meaning I'm losing heart here. His heart and the loss of hope is happening in him. He's just sick inside. He's overwhelmed with sorrow. Imagine all of a sudden just something happened and you had to get out of your house tonight and you just have to take off and you're headed to Barstow. I mean, it's like what the heck? I mean, he's overwhelmed. That's why his request is, lead me, guide me, direct me to the rock that is higher than I. Yes, David knew that the Lord was the everlasting rock, for God is never tired. We need to go to the Lord because he never gets tired. We get tired. We get wore out. God never gets overwhelmed. He's never afraid of the dark or anything that could ever happen to us. God has never forsaken David throughout his life, and he knows that. See, David knows that. There's one person I can go to in this traumatic situation, and I know that he'll be there for me. God was always there, no matter what the collapse or despair that happened in David's life. That's why David is still alive at this point as an older man. He's still able to cry out to the Lord because he's still alive. God has got him through all the sticky issues of his life. So he's able to cry out and say, I need you again. I need you again, Lord, help me. Notice how he speaks truth as a reminder to himself. He says in verse 3, for you have been a tower of strength against my enemies. A tower of strength. Understand, the Lord isn't just strong. He is a tower of strength. The word tower means the Lord is a tower that's attached to a defensive wall. It's the tower that's part of a fortress. That's what he's talking about here. You know, back in this day, you know, that's what stood against a huge army and people. See, they didn't have F-22 Raptors back there with laser-guided missiles. There was no ground artillery, you know, base that would launch bombs at them. You had high walls. You had towers of strength. And the higher the walls, the bigger the towers, the stronger and safer you were against an invading army. So that's who the Lord was to David. I wonder who the Lord is to us. I mean, do we trust no matter what unfolds in our lives, no matter what circumstances come our way, that the Lord is able to deliver us? Because when we get there, you know, that's when the peace of God will never leave us. When we get to that rock, when we get to the tower of strength, that's when the peace will stay in us. Now, if we don't cling to the rock, and we don't cling to the Lord as our refuge, our shelter, our tower, then if we don't do that, then the peace will not be inside of us that he's promised us. David, knowing that the Lord was close, he said in verse 4, he says, "Let me dwell in your tent. Now, I just want to have refuge and shelter with you." It's like, I want to be able to put my head down somewhere in the desert tonight, and I want to know that I'm with you, so no matter what happens, you'll be there for me. Because he doesn't know if Absalom, who's already talked in a lot of the military into going over to his side, he doesn't know if they're hot on his trail or what. And it's not like, you know, David can just go out running by himself. He's got a whole entourage with him. I mean, how fast are you moving with your wives, your kids, you know? I mean, you know, you got some military people with you. You got government people. I mean, you know, you got a whole horde of people here. You're leaving a big old trail, too. It's not like, hey, which way did they go? You know, like, well, here's the big, here's the big path where they're going right here. So, Lord, I want to be in your tent tonight, you know? And so, again, he wants to be in the shelter of his wings. That's the same analogy that Jesus used in Matthew 23:37, where he said, "Jerusalem, Jerusalem, who kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to her, how often I wanted to gather you together the way a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, and you were unwilling." So this whole thing about the wings, I mean, Jesus used that. It's like David wanted to be under the wings of the Lord, and Jesus used that same thing. He says, but the problem is with you, Jerusalem, when Jesus was here, you know, he said that when? He said it in Passion Week. He said it after, you know, Palm Sunday. It was on Palm Sunday that he said it, actually. And everyone's, you know, Hosanna, Hosanna. You know, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And the Lord knows just in a matter of a few days, those praises are going to go to crucify him. And he's going to be hanging on a cross. And so, you know, Jesus is like, how many times, me as the living God, I want to take you and put you under my wings. The very thing that David is asking, let me get under your wings. I want to be under your wings. God wants us to be under his wings. But 2,000 years ago on Palm Sunday, they didn't really want it then. But we should want it. We should want it for sure. Well, and because they didn't want it 2,000 years ago, it was 37 years later that Rome rolled into Jerusalem, put a siege against those high walls and towers, and they crushed Jerusalem, and they chased all of God's people out of Israel. And they were chased out until, by the grace of God, they were able to regain their homeland on May 14th, 1948. Yeah, they only went as punishment for having the Messiah crucified. They only went 1,878 years without a nation. Boy, think about that. Boy, you have no homeland to call your own. But that brings up our second point, a silent soul. Let's go now to Psalm 62, because these two psalms were written about the same time concerning the same situation. So there's a lot of similarities between the two. But let's jump to Psalm 62, verse 1. He says, "My soul waits in silence for God only. From him is my salvation. He only is my rock and my salvation, my stronghold. I shall not be greatly shaken. How long will you assail a man that you may murder him? All of you, like a leaning wall, like a tottering fence. They have counseled only to thrust him down from his high position, talking about himself. These people are all gathering around to see him fall. They delight in falsehood. They lie, they cheat. Anything to come in and take the kingdom away from me. They bless with their mouth, but inwardly they curse. Selah, think about that. What he's saying is a group of people have sided with Absalom. These were his own people. These were his yes men at one point. He says in verse 5, my soul await in silence for God only, for my hope is from him. He only is my rock and my salvation, my stronghold. I shall not be shaken. On God my salvation and my glory rest. The rock of my strength, my refuge is in God. Trust in him at all times. O people, pour out your heart before him. God is a refuge for us. Selah. Notice how he's not just writing for himself. He's including all of us. He's a refuge for us. Who's the us? It's the believers. It's God's sons and daughters. Again, notice how David repeats himself twice in verse 1 and verse 5. He says, my soul waits in silence. His defense was not in his military, because his military isn't at his hand right now, you know, that he won so many victories with. His peace is not in his wealth that he accumulated over the years. How much money could he take with him? Did he clean out his bank accounts? I mean, like, what's he got, a couple bags of gold with him? I mean, like, it's not in his wealth. Nor was it in his own personal charisma as the man after God's own heart, but rather his peace, his strength, his rest. It was all found as he waited in silence. Verse 1, verse 5. He waited in silence. He says it twice. Before the Lord. Let's not forget all the anxiety and worry that can wreak havoc to the depth of our souls. I mean, just think about all the things that can happen to us. And all that worry and all that anxiety, how does it help? It doesn't help. It does absolutely nothing. It just makes us miserable. Yes, you should be miserable. I am. Yes. Okay, there's nothing it can do for us. It can just hurt us more and more as we keep mulling over the worst case scenario. It can't change anything, though. All it can do is drive out our peace and separate us from God's peace in the midst of our hardships. Yet by waiting on the Lord, we give him the space. We give the Lord the space and the time to move in our lives. And God wants that. See, I don't know if you've noticed this or not, but the Lord usually doesn't just, boom, you know, bail us out of something in 2 seconds. He usually lets us hang in there for a little while. He wants us to learn lessons. He wants us to understand that he doesn't work in our timing, he works in his timing. But he's going to work. That's the point. And he wants us when we think, no, this is going to happen tomorrow or my life is over. It's like, no, it's probably not going to happen tomorrow and your life is not over tomorrow. Okay, so that's just, you know, that's the reality of it, okay? But many times we find ourselves doing something that seems to be more like Satan's answer. See, because we want to get our hands dirty. We want to get in there and fix it. We want to do whatever we can to try and make it better, which many times usually just makes it worse because we won't let it go. In verse 2, David reminds himself again who the Lord is. He is constantly doing this. He's always reminding himself of who the Lord is. He said, the Lord is my rock. The Lord's my rock. It's like maybe he's just reminding himself, and he's writing it down. The Lord is my rock. Like, remember that. Remember that. Everything else is sinking sand. But the Lord He's the rock, okay? He's my salvation. He's my stronghold. Think about how many times he says that between Psalm 61 and Psalm 62. He is saying that repeatedly. Maybe we could learn from that. How many times do we remind ourselves in times of trouble who the Lord is? Do we remind ourselves? Man, Lord, I can't believe this is happening. I can't believe what's going on here. Man, this is driving me nuts. Man, what am I going to do here? It's like, instead of all just having that attitude, maybe it's like, Lord, this is a mess, and I'm not sure how I'm going to get out of it, but you're my rock. Amen. See, I don't know what's going to happen here, but you're my stronghold. Lord, you're my strength. Lord, without you, like, I wouldn't even be here in the first place. I wouldn't even be living in Los Angeles. It's like, Lord, it's like, I just have to throw it all on your lap. Remember what the Bible says in Psalm 55, 22, cast all of your cares upon him because he cares for you. See, that's what we're supposed to do. And so it's like, Lord, I'm going to cast my cares upon you because you asked me to, because you're my rock, because I'm saved. You saved me. I'm your child. You're my Abba. You're my daddy. You're my papa in heaven. See, we have to keep reminding ourselves, because if we're not reminding ourselves of the good stuff, then we're going to be thinking of the bad stuff, right? I'm going to go down. I'm going to die. It's like I'm going to be overwhelmed here. There's no way out for me. See, no, that's not true. None of that is true. None of it is. You know, we have to remind ourselves, and maybe you need to hear this tonight, but it says in 1 John 4:4 that greater is he that is within us than he that is in the world. Okay, so whatever's coming against you, I just remember when we were buying this building, we were getting sued. We had someone that was kind of helping alongside here at the church. And they came to me and said, hey, we're looking for a building. He had this relationship with this particular real estate guy. And he goes, we have to sign a contract with him as he's looking for a building for us. I'm like, I'm not signing a contract with him. Well, then he's not going to look for a building. Well, I don't care. It's like, we'll get somebody else. We're going to buy a building. If someone wants to help us, they can help us and they can get their real estate commission. And if they don't, I'm not signing a contract. And he just kept talking to me, like, well, no, this guy, it's the way it's done. This is what you do, and da-da-da-da. And, every now and then, I listen to someone that I should not listen to. And that was one of those times. And it's like, I told him, like, multiple times, no, I'm not signing some contract. So I ended up signing the contract because this guy was his buddy, and he's going to help us, and he's going to da-da-da-da-da, and he's the greatest thing since butter popcorn, and da-da-da-da-da. And guess what? He wasn't the greatest thing since butter popcorn, okay? And so when we got this building, the owner of this building told me, he says, I will never talk to that guy, ever. And so we went over there for the very first meeting. I preached the gospel to the owner of this building for like 45 minutes before we ever talked about the building. And the guy never looked at the real estate guy, never. He says, I will only deal with you. If you want to buy my building, I deal with you, or you don't buy it. I'm like, oh, okay, well, yeah, I'll just deal with me then, And it's like, so it was just, look, a workman is worthy of his wage, but the guy didn't do anything. And we got sued for like 120 grand. And it was just, it was a nightmare. But I signed a contract, so we had to settle with the guy out of court, and we had to pay a bunch of money. But here's the good thing. The good thing is we had a lawyer that was fighting it for us, and he got it down to like, I think 30,000 or something like that. He paid 27,000 of it, the lawyer. Never charged us a penny for any of the lawyer fees to us. He did it all pro bono for the church, and then he paid the majority of the payout to the guy. It's like, where does that ever happen? Like, how does that, It's just, greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. But let me tell you, it was a lot of misery during that time when it was all happening. But David spells out the thoughts of his enemies in verse 3 and 4. They attack me. They want to kill me. They have said one thing to my face, and yet behind my back they've cursed me. Again, remember, it wasn't just his son Absalom that was pulling off this mutiny. there were several in David's leadership that were willing to dog David and join his son's mutiny attempt here. Maybe they were just greedy for gain. Maybe they thought they could get a raise when Absalom took over. Well, they should have known you can never prosper when you come against God's anointed. That's what they should know. And I remember talking to this guy that was suing us. It was his boss. I remember talking to him, and I just said, I want you to mark down this date, because, you know, once we got to the settlement or whatever, I said, I want you to mark this date down, because you are suing and you're getting God's money. So I just want you to know, mark this date down, and I want you to look back at this date 10 years from now and see where you are, because you will never prosper when you come against God's people. You know, so I did share that with him. I kind of enjoyed it too, but, you know, just like, I'm like, you know, you can't do that to God's people. But anyway, you can never be at peace when you do what is not right to better yourself, for it will always come back on you. And it will, you know, though, people will always reap what they sow. Consider what the Bible says in Proverbs 15, 16. It says, better is a little with the fear of the Lord than great treasure and turmoil with it. Get that again? It says, better is a little with the fear of the Lord than great treasure and turmoil with it. So it's like, you know, you're better off with a lesser amount and being at peace with God than having a bigger amount and being at odds with it. Yes, as David said in verse 5, my hope is in him. And because God was his rock, because God was his salvation, because God was his stronghold, David says with great confidence, I will not be shaken. I will not be shaken. It's the same as I will not be moved. I'm going to stand on the solid rock of Christ. I'm going to trust in him, and I will not be moved. I will not be shaken. Again, in original Hebrew language, David was saying, I am not going to be swayed. I am not going to stagger in my walk with the Lord. Again, David's in his older years now. He was resting on how faithful God has been in his younger years. This is why I think it's very important for us to write things down when the Lord does things in your life, because I think you forget. You forget. It's like when God is being faithful, you need to write those things down. Then you need to reflect on those things. Oh, yeah, I remember 20 years ago. See, I've been a Christian now for 46 years. I remember the Lord delivering me when I was 18, 19, 20 years old. I remember me and my wife first getting married and the issues and the situations that we came up against. I remember my youngest daughter almost passed away in a hospital. She was only 4 pounds when she was born, but this is like 38 years ago. So the technology for preemie babies, you know, 38 years ago is way different than it is today. And, you know, the doctors told us, well, she's not going to live. And, you know, yeah, I mean, I just... all of these things. So you have all of these issues. And when you go through hardship and you go through difficult times and the Lord delivers you, take good notes on those things, because God wants to use you to console other people. And also he wants to console you later, because you're going to have more problems, because it'll never be heaven in heaven. It's going to be heaven. Well, let me rephrase that. Because it is going to be heaven in heaven. Okay, what I meant to say was, it's never going to be heaven on earth. It's going to be heaven in heaven. And on earth, there'll always be hardship. There'll always be difficulties. But trust me, when we get to heaven, oh, it's going to be heaven in heaven. Okay, but while we're here, yeah, there's always going to be something's going to happen. I mean, it's just life. It's what happens, okay? But we don't have to be shaken. Let me ask you, are you maturing in your faith? Like, are you getting that? Like, are you going through the different battles in this life? Just all the inflation, just everything that's happening right now. You know, it's like thinking like, man, could you imagine 2 years ago us talking about the price of food now? I mean, it's just like, you got to be kidding me. I mean, it's like every time I go to the store, I'm amazed at how much stuff is. You know, I was buying this one cereal at Ralph's, okay, and it was like, I don't know, it was like $3.50 a box, you know, like 2 years ago. It's like $7.95 a box now. I mean, like, what? Like, I mean, like, how is that even possible? You know, it's like the oatmeal I was buying at Costco was, you know, like $8.95 for the big, what is it, like a 10-pound thing? It's like 2 5-pound bags or whatever it is. And it's like, now it's $12.95. I mean, it's not like things have gone up 50 cents. You know, it's like things are going up, you know, dollars, okay, dollars, okay? It's like Walmart has become my best friend. You know, it's like, do you shop at Walmart? Yes, I do. And proud of it, you know? It's like, you know, it's like, oh my goodness, you know? But it's just, you know, it's just crazy where we're at right now. But are you trusting the Lord more now? See, that's a sign of you maturing. You're trusting the Lord even though things are getting worse around us. Or are you regressing in the Lord? Because again, a sign of growth in the Lord is that you're directly connected to trusting him in the midst of the hardship that we're in. And David is not just thinking of himself in the midst of this mutiny. He's also thinking about everyone who's going to read this psalm, including us, 3,000 years later. 3,000 years later. Look again at the exhortation in verse 8. He tells us, trust in the Lord. At all times, when times are good and when times have turned raw. Notice he said, pour your heart out to him. Don't hold back. Shed every tear you need to shed. Allow yourself to be vulnerable. Expose your weaknesses to the Lord. Expose your deepest feelings to him. Cry out to him. Weep to him. You know, if it hurts, then let him know it hurts. Have sorrow. Have that pain. Let him know. It's not like the Lord doesn't already know, right? I mean, he already knows how you're feeling. He already knows how you're agitated. He already knows how annoyed you are. He already knows these things. So open up to him. Be raw with the Lord. Again, why? Because the Lord is a refuge for us. He is a shelter to protect us from the dangers and the distresses that are all around us. Which brings up our third and final point, a servant's reward. Let's read what he says here. Again, picking up in Psalm 62, we'll pick up in verse 9. It says, men of low degree are only vanity, and men of rank are a lie. He's just talking about rich people and poor people. In the balances, they go up. They are together lighter than a breath, meaning they're just like whatever to the Lord. Do not trust in oppression, and do not vainly hope in robbery. If riches increase, do not set your heart upon them. Once God has spoken, twice I have heard this, the power belongs to God. Don't sit there like, hey man, inflation is so high, let me go rob a bank. Let me shoplift. No. Everyone else is doing it. That's true. Everyone else is shoplifting, but not you, not as a child of God. Amen. Verse 12, and loving kindness is yours, O Lord, for you recompense or you repay a man and a woman according to their work. God will repay us. He'll repay us for walking with him in these times. He'll repay us when we're not angry and fight back when people get in our face. He'll repay us when we forgive, when no one else is forgiving. David calls it like it is in verse 9, though. He says, men of low degree, as the world would rank people, and men of vanity, people that are just going to be seen by others, and those who think they're really something here, for both have come against David, the rich and the poor. But he says, it doesn't matter if you're someone special in the world's eyes or if you're not. In God's eyes, they're lighter than a breath. Again, meaning nobody carries any weight with the Lord. For David has had every enemy imaginable try to kill him, okay, throughout his life. You think Goliath the giant wanted to kill him? Goliath said, hey, You send out a little kid to fight me? I'm the champion. I'm not going to have this little kid out here. He goes, I'm going to take you and feed you to the birds of the air. As David said, oh, yeah? Well, I'm going to take you, buddy boy, and all your entire army and feed them to the birds of the air. How about that? See, so everyone's tried to kill him. You know, King Saul tried to kill David. So who's the one that's been faithful to David? The Lord. The Lord. And he'll continue to protect him. He's protected him his whole life. He goes on in verse 10 and says, don't trust in oppression. Do not hope in stealing. Do not put your trust in riches. David knows that everyone helping Absalom is a dishonest person with ulterior motives. Yes, Absalom, we'll come against your dad with you. How can we help you? Yeah, trust me, they all have ulterior motives, like many of your politicians today have ulterior motives. Some looking to cash in, some looking for power, others have just hate in their heart. For everyone knows David was made king by the hand of God. And anybody with a relationship with God, those who have integrity, those people that walk with God, they're going to stick with David. And that's exactly what happened here. You had many people stick with David. And that was the downfall of Absalom, because the righteous stuck with David and they were able to overcome this whole thing. But those with those other motives, oh, they're going to go down with Absalom. They're going to go down in the end. Ahithophel was a guy that was David's like right-hand man. And yet he went down, he went and hung himself after this because he knew he betrayed David. And now that David was coming back into power once Absalom was dead, Ahithophel went and killed himself. See, they'll all be exposed in the end. Why? Verse 11, because all power belongs to God. That's why. All power. That's why we have to stick faithful with the Lord, because he's got the last say in everything. Doesn't matter. You know, it doesn't matter what the politicians do. It doesn't matter what Republicans or Democrats do. It doesn't matter. It's like God is going to have the last word. He will always have the last say in all the issues of our day and of our lives. And as he says, amen to that. And as he says in verse 12, loving kindness belongs to the Lord. And God will repay every single person for what they do. So if we live godly, God's going to repay that. He's going to reward us. People that live bad, they're going to reap what they sow. They're going to reap what they've sown. You know, they're stealing or taking advantage of the government right now. They're stealing or taking advantage of the system. Oh, it's all going to come back on them. It's going to come back on every single one of them. The Bible says this in 1 Corinthians 3:8. It says, now he who plants and he who waters are one. Now, this is the Lord talking about us, how we are the voice of reason in this time of chaos that we're living in right now. He says, so some of you are going to plant seeds of the Lord. Some of you are going to water those seeds. So, you know, sometimes when someone comes to know the Lord, it's because a lot of people have talked to them. There's been people that have come in and out of life. Anybody here, we had multiple people kind of talking to you about the Lord and just kind of like, okay. Okay, that happened with me. I mean, it was like I was having these little seeds that were getting planted in me, and they were watering. He says, but each will receive his own reward according to his own labor. See, so when you're faithful to do what God's asked you to do, to just plant those seeds, you know, just inviting people to church, telling them that God loves them, you know, whatever it is, you know, as you're planting those seeds, God will reward you, he says in 1 Corinthians 3:8, for we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field, God's building. See, when God wants to tell someone, like if he wants to tell somebody at your work tomorrow that he loves him, like the Lord's looking down. See, you don't know what someone's going through, right? So you don't know that the guy's going to leave or the gal's going to leave their spouse and they're just tore up inside and, you know, their marriage is on the rocks, their kids are a disaster, and yet they come to work and they put on the happy face, right? Just like you do at times, right? Don't we do that at times? Like, hey, how's it going? Oh, great. No, my life sucks, okay? But we tell people, oh, no, it's great. Everything's great. Yeah, maybe not so much, okay? So it's like if God wants to tell that person at your work tomorrow that he loves them, how do you think he's going to do it? Is he going to lift up the roof of your building? Hi, I'm God. Hey, you're not. No, He's going to use one of us, right? So now, what if it's one of your coworkers that God wants to tell that he loves? What if he puts that on your heart and you're like, yeah, but I don't know what to say. What if they look at me weird? What if they think I'm a Jesus freak? Well, it's because you are, okay? But it's like, we're co-workers together with the Lord, and we get the privilege of telling that person. I can't tell you how many times I've gone up to someone and said, hey, when's the last time somebody, okay, so it just happened again. So I'm having lunch yesterday, okay? I'm at KKLA. I'm having lunch yesterday with one of the main guys there. We went over to the hospital and prayed for his mom. His mom's in the hospital. She took a fall and she hurt her hip, and so she's in the hospital. And so we went over and prayed. Then we went over to the restaurant. I said, hey, when's the last time someone told you there's a God in heaven that loves you? You know, and it's just like, wait, hold on. I take that back. It was not yesterday. It was Tuesday, okay? Because my son took me for my birthday up the counter, okay? So, oh, man, we scarfed. He's like the burger with the jalapeno jack cheese, the bacon, the avocado, and a fried egg, you know, sunny side up, oozing all down. Okay, I'm sorry. It was killer. But so my son took me for my birthday. That's where it was. And because it was a young girl, because that gal yesterday was a little bit older gal. And so anyway, I said, when's the last time someone told you? She said, never. I said, well, guess what? You're hearing it right now. And I gave her a card. She put it in her thing, you know. And, you know, and so you know, invited her to the church. But here's another thing, you know, what Jesus said in Matthew 16:27. He says, for the Son of Man is going, you know, he's going to come in his glory and his Father with his angels, and will then repay every man, every woman for their deeds. He's going to repay. So for the bad, oh, they're going to reap what they sow. They're going to reap bad. For the good, for his children, reward, treasure in heaven. Amen? Amen? Let's pray. Father, we just come before you, Lord, and thank you so much for this opportunity to get into your word. And God, I just thank you so much, you know, for your grace and your mercy and your love. And I just pray, God, that God, you would speak, that that you would just cause the hearts of everyone here, Lord, to be sensitive to you, Lord. And if there's anyone here that finds himself distanced from the Lord, if there's anyone here that is just, you're not sure where you stand with God, I want you to know that the Lord loves you. That's why Jesus came. That's why he died on the cross. So that no matter how much you messed up, no matter how much you have been unfaithful, no matter how much you have failed, his grace is abundant. His grace outweighs your failure. His love outweighs your shortcomings. His mercy is much greater than your sin. And if you need to get right with the Lord here tonight, it's like, don't leave here without getting right with him. And so if that's you here tonight and, you know, you just don't know where you stand with God, and, you know, maybe your life's a little bit of a disaster. Maybe you're in deep with some sin issues in your life and you feel like you're sinking. Then with our heads bowed and our eyes closed, would you just raise up your hand between you and the Lord? I want to lead you in a prayer. God bless you. God bless you. Because the Lord knows where you're at. Anybody else in this last moment, God bless you. All right. God bless you. All right. I want to lead you in a prayer. Those of you that raise your hand, and maybe anybody else that's watching online that finds himself in that same position. Look, God doesn't hate you. He loves you. I'm sure he's disappointed with maybe some sin issue that we keep falling back into, like, are we doing this again? You know, I'm sure he gets disappointed at times with us, but it doesn't change his love for us. God loves us, and that's a love, that's a choice. He has chosen to love you, and that's what his unmerited love is. You can't merit it. He just has said in a blanket statement, I love you in spite of you. And so I want to lead you in a prayer, and this is a prayer of just asking God to forgive you. Now listen, God answers this prayer immediately. When you pray it and you mean it, this is an immediate answer. Sometimes we pray for things and we're not sure if it's going to happen or not. We're waiting on the Lord, but this is immediate. It's right now. It's instantaneous. All he asks from you is to be sincere and to be willing to turn from your sin. And if that's you, you pray this now. And God is going to forgive you. He's going to cleanse you. And if you have a thought 45 minutes from now that God didn't forgive you, that is a thought from the pit of hell. That is not true. God's word says when you come to him, he will forgive you, and there is no condemnation to those that are in Christ Jesus. So if you raise your hand, even if you didn't, if you're watching online, you pray this. You mean it, and God is going to forgive you. Pray this now. Lord Jesus, forgive me of my sin. You know the things that I've done, Lord, and you know the struggles that I have. But I ask that you would forgive me and help me to overcome these things. Yes, I believe you died for me, and I believe they buried you, and I believe you rose from the dead. But I give you my heart. Refresh me, renew me, cleanse me. Be my Lord, be my God, be my Savior, and be my friend. And fill me with your Holy Spirit. Strengthen me. Let me stand on the rock of Christ Jesus. Amen. 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 Well, listen, amen, yes. If you don't have one of our new believers' Bibles, we'd like you to get one. I don't care if you already have a Bible, but this has about 40 pages on the up front that really encourage you in walking with the Lord, okay, taking one step in front of the other. It's got an index in the back that you can look up words and issues that maybe you're dealing with. It'll give you some verses that deal with that issue. I've got some materials here for you also. So if you raise your hand, even if you didn't, if you prayed that prayer in a minute, please come up and see Pastor Abel. He does our young adults ministry on Friday nights at 7 o'clock right here in the sanctuary. So come up and see Pastor Abel, and he'll make sure that you get a copy of this. And if you're watching online, our desire is to send you a copy of these materials. We're not looking for any offering. This is a free gift from us to you, from the people here at Core Church Los Angeles to you. So you don't have to worry about sending us any money or anything. We just want to give this to you. So you can text us at 323-807-3255, or you can email us at bible@corechurchla.com. But either way, you give us an address that's good, and we'll get these in the mail to you. Well, with that said, why don't we stand up and sing this last chorus together, and may the Lord God bless each and every one of you. Amen.
God bless you, family. Have a beautiful evening. We'll see you Sunday.